Hello, everyone. My name is Dr. Yonit Arthur. I'm an audiologist and coach. You are on The Steady Coach. And today we are going to be talking all about tinnitus. Now, you may be wondering to yourself, why are we talking about tinnitus on a channel called The Steady Coach, where we talk about chronic dizziness all the time? Well, if you have tinnitus, there are really two possibilities here. One is that you don't have any other main symptom. It's primarily the tinnitus. And in that case, you have a whole lot in common with people with chronic dizziness symptoms, as you will discover later in this video. And in that case, all the other videos on my channel may actually be quite helpful to you in the recovery process. Option number two is you are a person who already deals with chronic dizziness, and tinnitus is yet another one of the annoying symptoms that you're dealing with. This video is going to be helpful for you too. Now, in this video, I'm going to be explaining why you can actually recover from tinnitus, not just manage it or cope with it or learn to live with it. If you've been dealing with tinnitus, chances are that you've already dealt with multiple medical professionals who've given you those kinds of messages, told you that it's incurable, and that your best options are, again, to manage, cope with, or learn to live with it. This is not true, as we're going to explore further in this video. But before we go into any of that, let's just define tinnitus for the purposes of this video. In this video, when I'm talking about tinnitus, I'm talking about sound that you're hearing. It may be high-pitched ringing, it may be buzzing, it may be roaring or rushing, it may be crickets. There are some other sounds you may have. Sometimes you might hear a heartbeat. That's known as pulsatile tinnitus, and an infinite variety of other sounds. However, for the purposes of this video, we're talking about medically unexplained sounds, meaning that you have tinnitus, you've been thoroughly medically examined, and there's really nothing wrong with you that explains why you have tinnitus, other than, for some of you, hearing loss, specifically sensory neural hearing loss, which refers to permanent changes in the inner ear and/or hearing nerve that lead to reduced sensitivity to sound. In other words, you don't hear as well as you used to. So to recap, if you have tinnitus and no hearing loss, and no medical problem has been found that explains your tinnitus, you're watching the right video. If you do have hearing loss and you have tinnitus, and no other medical problem has been found that explains your tinnitus, this video is for you as well. Back in the day, we thought of all sensory perception, so perception from any of your senses, including your sense of hearing, as a primarily bottom-up process. What that means for hearing is that we used to think that sound would go into your ear, it would be processed by your inner ear, go up your hearing nerve to your brain, and then your brain would take the information it got, process the sound, and then pop out a meaning for you. If we are basing our understanding of tinnitus on this old model, you can see why someone might tell you your symptoms can only be managed. The logic goes, okay, if this person is hearing sound, that sound's coming from somewhere in the hearing system, and the brain has no choice but to just hear that signal as sound. Again, this is old neuroscience. The way that the hearing system actually works is through a process called predictive coding. Predictive coding means that your brain doesn't just passively take signals from your senses and then pop out a meaning, that it actually uses expectations or predictions to try to figure out what might happen. And then it just compares the sense information to its predictions to figure out what's going on. This is a much more efficient process than it would be if your brain had to figure out what was going on every time something happened. It's kind of like if you were baking a cake that you baked 100 times and you were just baking a variation of that cake, but you already knew all the measurements, you already knew where all the ingredients were, you could whip out that cake really quickly. But if it's a brand new type of cake, a brand new recipe, every time you have to go consult your cookbook, you have to go get all your measuring tools, you have to go through your pantry and find all the ingredients each time, it would be a lot less efficient. So predictive coding dramatically increases our brain's efficiency. This is why it uses this particular method of understanding information from all of our senses. So when you hear something, what's happening is your brain is already predicting what the sound means before it's even fully processed the sensory information coming into your ear. You probably know this if you've ever misheard someone. Wow, I thought you just called my name, but you said something totally different. Or if you've ever played the game of telephone, when someone's whispering something in your ear and you think you hear something other than what they said. All of these things happen because your brain is always predicting what sound means before it's fully done processing things. This is also why when you're playing a game like telephone, or when someone calls your name and you didn't hear it because you thought they said something else, or you think someone called your name, but they were actually saying something else entirely. These mistakes happen because brains make errors. They're always trying to stay ahead of the game and predict what's going to happen, but sometimes they predict wrong. Now, generally speaking, this isn't really an issue because you can use context to figure out what went wrong with your understanding, and you can kind of fill in the gaps and say, oh, okay, now I know what really happened. But you could see how if the brain is getting a signal from your sensory system or somewhere else, and it starts misunderstanding what that signal means, especially if it starts tagging that particular signal as a dangerous signal, it might start reacting to it in a way that's not appropriate. In other words, because your brain's primary goal in your life is to keep you safe from danger, if it starts understanding a particular signal, either from your ear or from somewhere else, as dangerous, it will turn the volume dial up on that sound and it will draw your attention to it and say, look at this. This is really dangerous. This is a source of threat. And then you're going to start to hear and notice it more. Okay, so we have understood predictive coding. Now we want to understand, where does the tinnitus even come from? So the way that your auditory system works is you have many, many nerve cells called neurons that process sound at all the different levels of your hearing system. Now, nerve cells communicate with each other using electricity. And all nerve cells kind of have a constant electrical noise that they're always making, whether they're passing a new signal on or not. What this means is that neurons are always producing some background electrical noise. When sound comes in, that electrical noise might get higher or lower, but they're always producing some background electrical noise. Sometimes your brain interprets this electrical noise, this background noise. I think of it kind of like fan noise, like when your AC is running and you don't really notice it, but there's kind of a hum in the background. Sometimes your brain interprets that electrical noise as sound. This is actually completely normal. And in fact, the vast majority of people will hear that background electrical sound if the sound around them is quiet enough. What happens with tinnitus that becomes bothersome is either the electrical background noise goes up and the brain starts to become more likely to hear it as sound, or your brain just starts hearing the electrical sound as it always does, but it misinterprets that electrical sound as something important that you need to know about. And then it cranks up the volume so you hear it and notice it more. Now, it's true that when someone has sensory neural hearing loss, that background electrical noise may go up. So it may become more likely for the brain to actually interpret some of those electrical sounds as real sound. But what I think this whole management coping paradigm misses is that this still requires, crucially, that the brain still see that electrical sound as something important. So when people tell you that your tinnitus can't be cured or you can only manage it, what they're saying is you might have more electrical sound in your brain than you used to. We can't cure that. But who cares about that? I don't care about the electrical noise in your brain. I care if you hear a sound that bothers you. I care if you hear squealing or high-pitched ringing or whatever it is that your tinnitus sounds like. So we may not be able to cure electrical noise in your brain, and kind of not sure we want to, because that's just kind of a sign you're alive. What we want to recover from is hearing sound, annoying, loud sound all the time. And that is totally possible. And that's what you're not hearing when people tell you that you can only manage your tinnitus. The fact is, tinnitus is a prediction error. When we talked about predictive coding, you learned that the hearing system works by making predictions about what you're hearing and then interpreting sensory information and trying to decide if that sensory information matches the predictions or not. In your case, what's happening is your brain is predicting a threatening, dangerous sound and perhaps dangerous, threatening other things, which we will get to in just a moment. And then when it's looking for that dangerous sound, it's looking at this electrical noise that may or may not have been there beforehand, and it's interpreting that as a dangerous thing. So in order to recover from tinnitus, it's really the same process as I talk about everywhere else on my channel in terms of how to heal from chronic dizziness. In order to heal from tinnitus, we need to break this cycle of the brain over-responding to threat. Now, anyone who's gone to cognitive behavioral therapy or tinnitus retraining therapy has probably heard something quite similar, but there are two main differences here in this video versus what you've heard before. The first is that I think it is a huge disservice to people like you when a provider starts their work with you by saying you can't recover. As we discussed earlier, that doesn't make sense in light of the fact that hearing is always a prediction cycle. And as long as your brain stops predicting the tinnitus sound, you're not going to hear it, even if the electrical activity in your hearing system doesn't change. The second is that in many cases, cognitive behavioral therapy and tinnitus retraining therapy focus only on your reactions to symptoms. And this is a very important component of getting better from tinnitus, to stop the fear thoughts, the anxiety, the worries about what it means, the kinds of behaviors, especially avoidance behaviors, where, for example, you might avoid being in silence altogether because you're afraid of hearing the sound. People can develop all sorts of unhealthy habits trying to get away from their tinnitus, and that can increase fear and make your brain look for threat even more, which increases the volume of the sound. These are really important components, but in my opinion, they are not looking at the whole picture. We are missing the context of you and your life and what things have been going on in your life, maybe recently, maybe less recently, that have caused your brain to become more sensitive than average to threat. Again, we want to address this cycle of tinnitus in which we address fear, anxiety, and avoidance. But there are other things in your life, because you're a whole person, that can affect how sensitive your brain is to threat. Here's an example. Let's say we have two people who work the exact same job. They have the exact same boss. Stressful project is due very soon. One of them grew up in a house with a very critical parent and became a huge perfectionist and is constantly putting himself down. Let's just say the other person grew up in a more average house and didn't develop some of those strategies for dealing with stress. Who's going to respond with more alarm if something goes wrong with the project? And I'm not talking about on the outside, because a lot of people learn great coping skills when they've had hard times earlier in life. I'm talking about how much threat, how much danger your brain thinks that you're in, how it interprets outside stressors. So things that have happened in your life previously set your nervous system up to develop chronic tinnitus, because your brain ends up being more sensitive to threat and it's more likely to interpret that electrical noise we keep talking about as a sound and as a dangerous sound that you need to know about. So recovery from tinnitus requires, yes, learning how to deal with the fears and anxiety and avoidances, more behavioral things, but also looking more closely at the non-tinnitus related stressors in your life both present and past, that may be causing your nervous system to react in an overly sensitive way. You may be asking yourself, okay, I'm kind of buying that. That makes sense. How do I do this? That is the topic of every other video on my channel. And I'm going to post a few suggested viewing videos in the video description about emotions, about stress, about how to work with fears and thoughts that I would really like you to watch. And when you watch them, I want you to just kind of cross out the word chronic dizziness in your mind and insert the word tinnitus, because they completely apply to you. In addition, I have a free course that is intended for people with chronic dizziness, but again, the same tools, the same resources, the same techniques apply regardless of which symptom you have, because like with chronic dizziness, the problem you're dealing with is a threat prediction problem. And that is all addressed through the same techniques, regardless of how the symptom ends up showing up. You are welcome to take the free course as well. That is also linked in the video description. And in the future, I plan to offer a free course for those of you with tinnitus and hyperacusis, which is the topic of a different video, so that you have tinnitus and hyperacusis specific language in the course and don't have to mentally cross out the word dizziness all the time. That being said, you don't need to wait around for that. Go take the free course. All right, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. Hope this was helpful. I know I explained things in a very different way from how you're probably used to hearing about tinnitus, but this is really, really essential. The first component of recovery from symptoms is knowing it's possible. And if I were to just jump on that management coping train, I'm essentially nocebo-ing you, basically putting the belief in your head that recovery is not possible, when that's simply not true. If you don't hear tinnitus anymore, or the tinnitus no longer bothers you and it's just an occasional thing, I don't know what else to call that other than recovery. Looking forward to your questions and comments. Please leave them below. And if you like this video, please like it, share, subscribe to my channel. All these things help me reach more people. Looking forward to hearing from all of you. Take care. Bye-bye.